Yes, just moving slightly off that sort of rowing focus. You were the sport legacy champion off the back of the 2012 Olympics. Do you think that sort of program, the legacy program, is being a success, and do you feel that you're personally adding some good value to that?
I think it has worked reasonably well. It's something that almost on a daily basis gets talked about. There wasn't really enough funding to be able to really put out a first-class athletes legacy program. Material-wise, from the games, I think has worked really well and still working well 2 years away from the games. But we could have done better in the legacy. But they just the financial climate that we came through, there wasn't the finances around to really put good programs involved. But saying that is that because the sports did really well, is there has been an influx of people wanting to try most of the sports that they saw at the Olympic Games, and that has worked incredibly well. The attitude has changed. It's not just about football, rugby, cricket. That people will now try lots of different sports because of what London did. And you've only got a short window to be able to capture that, and we're starting now to move away from that. The functions I go to, they still talk about 2012, but that was 2 years ago, and that will fade in the memory. And without resources being put into programs like that, then it will fade away. And that's just the nature of any country that competing at the Olympics. If you look through the history, whoever hosts the Olympic Games, they normally perform very well 4 years afterwards, and then it slides off a slippery
To
slope.
keep it going.
So to me, I always said that it was how we do in 2020, not how we do in 2016. I'm almost given that we're going to perform quite well in 2016 because of how well we performed at London and the programs that we put in. So of the sporting giants and other talent identification is that very few of those athletes got into the team in whatever sport, but they've captured enough that they're going to try for Rio. So we'll have a strong British team competing at Rio. It's what happens after that. And success for London 2012 for me, as I say, is how we do it 2020.
That's where the real legacy lies, yeah. And you have some charity work with the Sporting Promise with Matalan, which looks a really great thing I think to help kids ensure that they're in sport regularly. Can you tell us a bit about that and how it fits in with rowing in particular as well?
In some ways, that's a scheme that has helped the legacy programs in some ways, even though it wasn't direct 2012 legacy, and we were starting before it. We're now into our fourth year. And the really, there's several elements to it, and the base element is a primary school. If you're a teacher at a primary school, especially if you're in a community like where I live in Marlow, is that my primary school, the teacher used to teach English, maths, science, sport, arts and crafts, did everything. So you have to have a broad knowledge of it. A teacher training of becoming a teacher, you only have 2 days of learning how to teach sport. So if sport isn't your thing, you're going to find that really difficult to engage with to be able to pass the passion on to the youngsters. If you're in a bigger community, you tend to have a teacher that will specialise it within the area. Now, don't get me wrong, we've got some fantastic sports primary school teachers out there, but the reality is that not all of them are comfortable within the role. So we give them extra tools to be able to do their job, extra training to be able to enhance that. And to me, that's the key element of people coming out of primary school, going into secondary school with a little bit more skill-based. We tend to concentrate more on the skills than doing the sport itself. It's easier if you've got one teacher teaching 30 kids in a classroom of English. It's easier to get them out onto a football field or a netball court and carry on that sort of same format. Not every child is going to be good at English. Not every child is going to be good on the sports field. You need to adapt it in certain ways and find the elements that are out there. I believe there is a sport out there that will suit every child's physical makeup, but we can't offer all those sports. So it's more of basing the skill level at primary school. And then when we get to secondary school, there's almost this stigma of changing of when you are at primary school, you will try anything you're asked to do. And then suddenly in those summer holidays between primary and secondary school, there's a little trigger that comes in thinking, I'm not good at sports, I'm not going to do this, I'm not going to go out. And you try, some people try to avoid doing that. So we introduce sports like dodgeball, ultimate frisbee, parkour, jump rope, street cheer, very things that a lot of people have never heard about. There's no stigma attached to it and you tend to get involved in it. We have a big drop off of teenage girls when they leave school that have not taken on activity. So something like a jump rope, ultimate skipping in some ways, that they seem to enjoy. And they love taking the mickey out of the boys when they can't do it very well, as I'm one of them that can't do it very well. And also with the street cheer, it's dance with music. It's sort of allowing the sort of American idea of cheerleading, but a little bit more of street wise from that point of view, and that's very engaging. It's all about being active and being part of that, so that's working really well. And then what we've brought in this last year is Sporting Pro is a retailer, it's a new retailer, but 1% of their takings go back into the project. So they're supplying sports clothing, sports equipment, but they're also funding the program as well. So we can widen the program, get more people involved. In the 3 years that we've been active and in the fourth year that we are, we've touched over 2 million young people at the moment. And it's been looked at as a very successful program and hopefully it'll carry on for many more years to come.
Great. And obviously the emphasis on getting children to sport you see as important to bring through the next generation. There's programs like Sporting Promise to try and help to improve that. Do you think that there's a general underlying theme of a lack of investment in funding in this sort of children's sports? And do you think are you involved in any sort of lobbying with government or in other levels to try and get more emphasis on that?
There's always a lot of lobbying going on and trying to increase more programs. It is trying to get a balance. British sport, I think overall, has never been as well funded as it is now, leading up to 2012 and coming out of 2012. My concerns is that when we get to 2016, is that things may change at the elite level. But we still need to investing in our young people. I think sport gives you a well-rounding balance within life, society, of learning how to conduct yourself in a competitive environment or in an active environment, of the self-esteem, confidence that you can build from that, of just generally how leading your life. So I think sport has a huge element to play and it's something that we should embrace more and not play down. And I'm not talking about elite level, this is more about of grassroots at school level. School criteria have changed so much in the last 20 years. More emphasis has gone on to exam results and set tests. And sports and activity has been sort of pushed to one side. Because the culture that we live in now is that I used to go down to the primary school just down the road here and used to walk to school. A lot of parents now will drive their kids there, drop them off, and then pick them up in the evening. So the activity they get is more or less of what they get at school. So the emphasis should be more about school activity than less. Governments will always, and whichever government will say, oh yeah, we're doing more, we're doing so many hours a week, more than the last government. The reality is, whatever it is, it's not enough, and it still needs to be pushed up. Obesity rates going up, technology levels of PlayStations and electronic gadgets, 24-hour TV of whatever age you are, there is something that will engage you in the TV world. When I was a kid, there were only three stations, two stations were part of that, and there was only a small segment for children's TV. Now it's there 24 hours a day. So you're drawn into that aspect. And it's about being more active. and knowing the restraints that we have in society, that we should be moving more to making sure that we're still active all the way through. And the key area to do that was within schools. So there has to be a balance. You can't say, oh, academia is not important, because obviously that's crazy. But to say that sport isn't an activity isn't important with school, then you've got to bring those closer together.